Let's say you're sitting at your computer and you're working on a project and suddenly you feel a headache coming on. What are the reasons why that headache could be coming on? And is there something that you could be doing to prevent that headache? Today, we're going to find out from an expert all the things that you can do to understand your headaches and prevent them when possible. This is Dr. Nada Hindiyeh. She is the clinical assistant professor of neurology at Stanford University in California. And she's here again to talk to us about other kinds of headaches. We did an episode previously that you will find fascinating on migraines and migraine aura. So check those out. But for today, we're going to be talking about other kinds of headaches that could be related to posture, stress, and other reasons. Welcome back to the show, Dr. Hindiyeh.
Thank you so much for having me again.
We're pleased. So you hear about tension headaches, and we were talking earlier about posture, which is one of the things that really will protect you from repetitive strain injury and many other problems. So what about if we start at posture? Would that be good?
Yes. So, you know, posture is so important, especially now when most of us are working from home. And we're in front of a screen, but we may not have the best ergonomic setup for us at home. So we have to be very vigilant about where our body is in space and to make sure we're feeling comfortable throughout the day. And then when it comes to posture, you know, making sure you're in a position where you're not feeling strain on any part of your body. And then, of course, taking breaks so you're not in any one position for hours or for long periods of time. So when we think about like the muscles in our neck and the muscles in our back, there are a lot of muscles there that can get very tight. And we've all experienced this. There's times when we feel like, okay, I really need a massage. And there are some nerves that even run up the back of the neck and up the head that can get irritated through that process. And those are called the occipital nerves. And those can trigger headaches just in those areas. They can also trigger migraine headaches. So we wanna make sure that we kind of keep our muscles loose and so we're not triggering those types of headaches.
One of the big problems with repetitive strain injury is the forward head posture, you know, where people, ideally, the head would be right on top of the spine, mm-hmm. but as time goes by, it gets further and further and further yes. down. And so for every inch forward, there's three times the amount of pressure on the neck muscles. Is that the sort of thing you're talking about? Or would exactly. it be a situation where someone has bifocals and their glasses aren't properly fitted for the screen, so they're tilting their head back.
So headaches aren't actually attributed to a change in blood supply. It is actually more so a nerve system that's being affected. And with any postures that are not, like you said, we want to keep our heads upright. When our heads are either going down or going up, you're putting strain on those nerves and those muscles when there shouldn't be a strain on them. And that can be that big trigger there.
So you're going out of the neutral. I'm very fond of the Blix curve. If you've heard of it, you know, the part where everything is happy and long and in good posture. And the minute you violate that, you have problems.
Exactly.
And so many of the, this is so interesting because I hadn't thought of the neck in terms of the Blix curve until you just said, you know, looking too far down, looking too far back.
Yes, exactly. And, you know, that's why it can be hard because you may not recognize it until your headache has started or your headache is already becoming bothersome.
So getting back to the occipital nerves, can you run down how that would happen? So the nerves come up behind the cranium or something?
Yes. So, you know, that we have some big muscles back here, but we also have these nerves that essentially run up your neck and they can even trigger pain that goes. So these nerves go all the way forward up on your head. So people can even feel this pain behind their eyes or in the top of their head. And, you know, sometimes if you feel around the area back there, you can even trigger that kind of pain. And if that's if those spots are becoming tender or bothersome, you may be straining that nerve too much. And what can happen with that nerve is that that nerve, you know, internally connects to the nerve system that's associated with headaches in general and with migraine. So then it can trigger these other types of severe headaches like migraine headaches too.
That is so interesting. So do you think that eye strain can trigger headaches?
Absolutely. Absolutely. And, you know, we've seen, especially this year, eye strain and more headaches because of screen time. So, you know, eye strain can really cause headaches that feel like they're right behind the eyes. And there was actually a study that showed that, you know, this can cause other symptoms too, and people can get dry eyes. But in people who are prone to headaches, dry eyes and eye strain can feel even more significant and severe pain than people who aren't prone to headaches. So even that screen time and being in front of the screen for a short amount of time can trigger a more severe and significant headache too.
Wow. All of this is so connected.
It really is. It really is. Because those nerves that, you know, there's a nerve system that runs throughout the entire face, the head, the neck, called the trigeminal nerve system. And those are all the same nerves. So they're behind the eye. So those the eye pain and symptoms you feel also connect to that system and are also similar to the headaches and the nerve system involved in migraine.
So if we were going to talk about headaches and put them in little, I don't know if this is possible or if they're too interconnected, but stress headaches, I don't even know if they use that term anymore, migraine headaches, cluster headaches. I mean, there's so many different kinds of headache.
So we can think of a couple different big buckets when it comes to migraine. So migraine headache or regular headaches in general. So we have migraine headache. And we talked about that on our earlier episode and kind of the definition of migraine. So those are fairly long, they're debilitating, they're associated with either some nausea or some sensitivity to light, and they can last several hours. But these can be triggered by many things, including stress, including eye strain, including increased screen time, and especially kind of just not being on a regular routine with your everyday habits. And then we have tension type headache, which is very, very common. So the way I think about tension type headache is think about it as the opposite of migraine. It's not bothersome. It's not going to stop you from doing your normal everyday routines. So when we look at when people come to the clinic to see their physician about a headache, if it's bothersome enough to have taken you to a doctor's office, it's probably not a tension type headache. It's probably something more debilitating like migraine. Yeah. And with tension type headache, you're not generally going to have nausea. You're not going to have a sensitivity to light. You're not going to be bothered by light at all.
You know, when we talked in the earlier episode, you were talking about preventive measures that people could take. Yes. Aerobic exercise, yes. Regularity in their meals, regularity in sleeping well. Is that similar with other kinds of headaches?
Absolutely. Regularity can be very important for all types of headache, including tension type headache, including headaches associated with your screens. Your brain just gets very used to being on a routine. So when it's thrown off, any type of headache can be triggered, whether it's migraine or, you know, tension type headache.
This is really, really interesting stuff. And I'm hoping that people really take it to heart, you know, get up and walk around. I mean, if you're working at home, you can get up and march in place while you're thinking about something. You don't have to sit there.
Yes, exactly. Exactly.
And the wonderful thing about that is that the calf muscles are pumping the blood back up to your brain. So it helps you with generating ideas and feeling fresher and that sort of thing.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
So if people do have headaches, I guess the go-to thing that most people think of would be taking aspirin, Excedrin, Tylenol. Is there anything, are there natural non-pharmaceutical remedies that are helpful for headache?
Of course. So yes, there are many actual natural supplements that have been shown and proven to help prevent headaches. So when taken daily, the three vitamins I generally recommend are magnesium, riboflavin, which is vitamin B2, and coenzyme Q10. But the caveat here is that they're generally a lot higher doses than you would find in a multivitamin. So magnesium, I generally recommend about 500 milligrams a day. With riboflavin, it's 400 milligrams a day. And with coenzyme Q10, it's 300 milligrams a day. So studies have shown that over time, over a few months' time, what you'll see is a decrease in frequency and severity of headaches when taking these vitamins.
That is absolutely amazing. I had no idea that the dietary supplements would be useful in this regard.
Yes. Yeah.
And that studies actually support this. That's amazing.
Yes. Yeah. We really like to go by evidence-based medicine. And, you know, clinical studies have been done on these and they do show effect. So especially when people don't want to take prescription medications, these are wonderful options to try.
Thank you so much for sharing all of this information with us. Is there anything we've not covered about headache, stress headaches, or other screen-related headaches that we need to hear?
You know, if you're having a lot of trouble, especially with screens, especially and with posture, certainly talk to your doctor about it, because there are certain exercises that could be helpful too for your neck. And then sometimes, you know, even seeing a physical therapist can be helpful. So don't hesitate to ask your doctor about options for treatment.
I think it's really good. And I also think it's really good to get good guidance. I myself am a certified personal trainer and yoga teacher, but I really believe that it's good to have, first of all, have your doctor overseeing everything and knowing what you're doing, and then steer you toward really competent, smart people, because they can be so helpful. But doing the wrong exercise or the wrong yoga pose can really get you into more trouble.
Exactly.
So
yeah.
I think it's really good to get expert advice when you're embarking on something like that. And also the other thing I tell all of my people is listen to your own sensations.
Yes.
If something is bothering you, doesn't feel right for any reason at all, stop. Let the person know what's going on and see if you can modify it somehow, skip it, go on, avoid that exercise, because there's just so many things that can go wrong. I mean, I do not teach headstand, shoulder stand. There's all sorts of things that I don't do because there's just so much pressure going on. And I think it's so much better to do a little bit of wonderful stuff that will really help people without risking something because you wanted to achieve a certain pose.
I agree 100%. You know, we have to be very mindful of our bodies and our limitations too.
Yes. Yes. I mean, I think that's really good advice. Thank you so much, Dr. Hindiyeh. We really loved having you here and hope you'll come back sometime.
You're very welcome. Thank you for having me.